We have to tell you, he's going to be Frank. It's funny, thought his name was David.
A perfectly idyllic rural setting, you might think. But you'd be wrong, because this river is so polluted with pesticides from neighbouring fields that fish taken out of it have been shown to contain over 100 times the permitted levels of organodimutron, a powerful pathogen which, if ingested, can induce fever, convulsions, severe nervous disorders, and in some cases, coma. Indeed, so dangerous is organodimutron that it has been recently placed on the American Food and Drug Administration's list of the 10 most deadly liquids. And to add insult to injury, the crop that has been sprayed with this highly dangerous chemical is in fact not needed. It's been grown entirely for the large EEC subsidy that it attracts. In tonight's programme, we're going to be looking at modern farming methods and the long-term damage that they're doing to the land, and asking these questions. Do Europe's farmers really know what they're doing? And if so, why are they doing it? This is Apple Tree Farm in Sussex, where farmer Richard Rackham runs a large-scale livestock operation. Right, Richard, here we are in one of your chicken sheds. It does seem extremely full. Should you have 7 chickens in each cage like this?
Oh, yes, couldn't get any more in. And any fewer would mean that they might be able to move about, which could lead to them squashing the eggs.
But wouldn't it be quite a lot kinder to let them move around just a little?
No, not really. Give them too much freedom, they'll pick each other's necks.
And I suppose they might do each other some harm that way.
Yeah, or worse still, they might miss and hit an egg.
I suppose it's as a further precaution against this that you've tied all their heads to the cage there at the side.
That's right, yeah. Got to keep them beaks away from the eggs if you want to make a decent living at this game. Careful, that's electrified.
Yes, thank you. So it is. To the untutored observer, I have to say they do look extremely uncomfortable. I suppose you'd disagree.
Oh, dunno, really. Never thought about it. Probably is very uncomfortable, I should think. I wouldn't like it, would you?
No, not at all.
Mind you, they might even be enjoying it. Bloody stupid animals, chickens.
Well, we've left the chicken sheds now, and we've come to see the second element in Richard Rackham's operation, pigs. That's right, isn't it, Richard?
That's right, yeah.
Right, well, let's go in then. So, tell me, Richard, what made you decide to specialise in pigs and chickens?
I find that pigs and chickens are very compatible. The pigs can eat the chicken shit and the chickens can eat the pig shit.
You feed the animals with each other's manure?
Yeah.
Do they like it?
Dunno, never thought about it.
Well, I'd like to be able to say that they seem to be thriving on it, but I can't actually see any of them. Tell me, is it always as dark as this in here?
Well, I don't know, I don't come in here all that much.
Do you have any lights or windows?
Oh, no, I couldn't justify an expense like that. They're only pigs, you know.
The ventilation isn't too good either, is it? There really is a most overpowering smell in here.
Oh, I know, it's a terrible stink, isn't it? That's why I don't come in here much. Of course, if it were left to me, I'd clean it out once in a while, but our accountant won't let me.
No, I'm terribly sorry. I'm afraid I'm going to have to be sick.
That's all right. Do it anywhere. Pigs do. That's right, yeah, let it all out. Go on.
If today's livestock farm seems a long way removed from the traditional image, tomorrow's will be even more so, at least if agricultural researchers like Dr. Guy Chabot, director of France's Institut de Technologie Agricole, have their way.
Yes, by employing advanced genetic techniques, we have made many improvements to the inefficient animals we have for many centuries used on the farms. Recently, for example, we have developed this, which we call the super cow, because it consumes half the feed of a conventional cow, but it produces 3 times the milk.
Well, that's remarkable. And can it produce such high yields indefinitely?
No, after 6 months it dies, of course. Don't you think it is a wonder cow?
Well, you call it a super cow?
Super cow, yes. Wonder cow, no. You cannot expect miracles.
I must say, from the cow's point of view, it seems a bit of a backward step.
But listen, if you want to make an omelette, you have to break a few eggs. If you want to make an omelette with cheap and milk, you have to break a few cows. That's life.
People like Dr. Guy Chabot and farmer Richard Rackham are the declared enemies of various animal rights groups, probably the most extreme of which is the so-called Creature Militia. A representative of this secretive organization agreed to speak to us, provided we pointed out that the disguise she wore for the interview contains absolutely no animal products.
The Creature Militia exists to highlight the plight of many animals in this country and to increase awareness of the public at large of the levels of exploitation to which they are often subjected.
How do you intend to accomplish this?
By hitting people.
Over the years, your organisation has been involved in some highly controversial activities, hasn't it? For instance, there was your kidnapping of the Crufts Best of Breed toy poodle, Carrington Dionysus Trixie Evergreen Ferroconcrete III.
This animal's being exploited. We've given it a new life, a new hairstyle, and a new name. It's been totally re-educated.
What is its new name?
Dog.
And in what way has it been re-educated?
It's now vegan.
A lot of people in this country have a lot of broad sympathy with your aims, but are alienated from you by your methods.
They needn't be. It's really just a question of what order you choose to do things in.
What do you mean?
Some people say they resort to violence only when other ways have been tried and they failed. We say we'll resort to violence first, and if that fails, we'll try some other ways afterwards.
Well, I think an attitude has been fostered in this country which is as regrettable as it is over-sentimental. An attitude which insists on seeing animals as something more than what they really are, which is to say, walking meat.
Yes, of course, one of the principal complaints about factory farming methods is that animals are often kept in such confined spaces that they don't have the freedom to walk at all.
Very well, then, if you prefer it, stationary meat. It amounts to the same thing.
But do you not think, though, Minister, that it is desirable to ensure that the animals enjoy certain basic standards in terms of their living conditions?
Animals do not have the same values as you or I, David. They have no sense whatsoever of hygiene, as anyone who's watched a dog for any length of time will tell you, and they possess an entirely different concept of comfort. Present a car with a leather armchair, and it's more likely to regard it as a relative than as a piece of luxury furniture.
Nevertheless, aren't these animals entitled to some compassion?
These animals aren't pets, you know, David. They're working animals. They have a job to do.
A job which seems to involve living in dark, filthy conditions and eating manure until they're fat enough to be killed.
Yes, well, it's not a job which would hold much appeal for you or I, David, but you have to remember these creatures have no qualifications, so they really aren't entitled to expect anything better.